So, good morning. I'm aware that not everyone here is an expert in nonlinear optics yet. You will see in 30 minutes, maybe it will change. I want to talk about some work that we are doing on functional nonlinear photonic crystals, but I guess I have to explain some things before this. So I will start with some very basic introduction on nonlinear optics, nonlinear optic interactions, and quasi-phase matching, which is a very important concept we have to understand in order to understand what we are doing. And then I will, once we have this basic knowledge, we can discuss some nonlinear photonic crystals. I will mainly talk about quasi-periodic structures. We heard yesterday some nice presentation by Kobe on quasi-periodic structures in soft matter. Here, this is synthetic quasi-periodic structure with using nonlinear optics. And then I will show how this can be used to, and we can add some functionality to the device, and I will show you some examples of deflectors and beam shapers. So let's start from the basics. So what happens when light gets into a material, into a dielectric material? So what happens is, this is an electric field, and then we have this material. And what happens inside is that the electric field induces dipoles. So here you can see these dipoles. And the reason we have dipoles is because we have, in an atom, we have a nucleus and electrons which have opposite charge. And therefore, the electric field acts in differently on the them. So for example, here this is an atom. Okay, this is a very simple atom where we have a nucleus and an electron which are connected with a spring. And now we send the light into it, and what happens is we induce this dipole. Therefore, it acts mainly on the electron because the nucleus is very heavy. And once we have this, then we have this oscillating electron or oscillating dipole, and this will also radiate light. So This oscillation is at the same frequency of the electric field that was sent. And we can look at this dipole. This is polarization, is the dipole moment per unit volume. It's simply proportional to the electric field that we are sending. And the proportionality is this, it's called chi1. It's a material property, and it determines the absorption of the material, and also its refractive index. So what happens when we have a nonlinear material? So what happens is now that this spring has some nonlinearity. It means that when we send light into the material, we will get some oscillations, not only in the fundamental frequency, but also at some harmonics of it. And therefore, we have not only this, but we have some second-order effect and third-order effect. So second-order effect, this is the main thing that I will discuss. This can lead to frequency doubling or to some frequency generation. And if we can also have a third-order nonlinearity where we can generate third harmonic, or we can change the refractive index, this is called Kerr effect, or we can also have stimulated Raman scattering. Okay, so this is just an example of nonlinear optics. Here we have red light, and we send it to a nonlinear material. And maybe you can see, I don't know if you can see, there is some blue light coming out of it. So this is second harmonic generation. And so basically this is a mixer. We send two frequencies, omega 1 and omega 2, and we can get some frequency or the difference frequency or the second harmonic. And so for this process to happen, we need to satisfy energy conservation. This always happens. But we also need to satisfy momentum conservation, because these are the photons that we send in, and also the photon we generate, have a momentum, and there is a momentum conservation condition. We can also understand this condition if you look here. So this is where it is satisfied. So this is our electric field, and now we induce these dipoles, and we generate light at some harmonics. And now all these electric fields are in phase, and therefore we have constructive interference here. So this is a very efficient process. But usually it doesn't happen. Unfortunately, what usually happens is what is shown here, that we have we have this dipole radiates, and this dipole radiates at the same frequency, but we don't have the same, they are in opposite phase. So therefore, they cancel each other. And then these two cancel each other, and so on. So basically, rather than having a very very efficient process, we'll have some small oscillation. The light will go up, go down, go up, go down. And here you can see this is an example. This is on the top surface of a nonlinear device, so you can see these oscillations, and the efficiency is very small in this case. And I should say this is usually what happens. Usually this is what happens because the material has dispersion, and therefore the second harmonic and the fundamental don't have the same phase velocity. Now there is a simple way to solve it. If we could reverse the phase of the light that is generated in these areas, then this problem is solved. And this can be done if we can reverse the sign of the nonlinear coefficient. So again, this is the problem, this is the fundamental, this is the polarization, the second harmonic, this is the electric field, and you can see they run out of phase. But if we reverse, if we do some periodic reversal in the sign of the nonlinear coefficient, then each time we put them back in phase again. So this is why we can get good efficiency. And in fact, this is not a new idea. It was proposed by Blombergen back in 1962, but it took many years to find a good way to do it. This is in fact what we want to have. So we want to have some crystal where we have modulated nonlinearity. The refractive index, the linear refractive index is constant, but the nonlinearity is modulated. And once we do it, so this is what happens. If we are not doing it. Then we'll have these oscillations of the second harmonic that I showed you before. If we are fortunate to have a phase matching, then we'll have this quadratic rise in the efficiency. But usually we don't have it. We have these oscillations. So if we fix it by modulating the nonlinear coefficient, then we'll see this green line. So it's a little bit less than the perfect case, but it's much better than what we have here, which is essentially nothing. And the good thing is now this is something that we can control, because whether we are fortunate to be here or not, that does not depend on us. It's a material property. But this is something that we can engineer. We can design the right period in order to be in this condition. And also we can look at the momentum conservation diagram. So these are the k vectors of the input wave and the output wave, and now with this modulation we get another k vector that solves the phase matching problem. So I said the idea is not new, but only let's say in the last decade there are now good ways to make it. And in fact, this made a revolution in nonlinear optics. And we need a way to modulate the nonlinear coefficient with micron scale resolution. And this is the way. This is the most successful way it's done. It's by electric field pooling of ferroelectric crystals. So ferroelectric crystals are crystals where all the electrical dipoles are pointing in the same direction. And the method of electric field pooling is based on using techniques of photolithography. We put some periodic electrode on one side and a planar electrode on the other side, and then we apply a high voltage pulse. And if we do it under the right conditions, wherever we had the contact of the metal with the material, we reverse the sign of the dipole. And this is a permanent reversal. We can then remove the electrodes, and we have this periodic modulation of the dipoles. And the important thing for us is when we reverse the sign of the dipole, we reverse the sign of the nonlinear coefficient. So therefore, we can solve the problem of phase matching. And here you can see this is a wafer, and we have here some gratings that were written this way. The typical periods are in the range of several microns. The state of the art is below 1 micron, so maybe this justifies why I'm in a nano conference, but really it's in the micron scale. And the thickness is about a millimeter, although the state of the art is about 5 millimeter. So the aspect ratio is very large. It's about 1,000. I mean, this is maybe a few microns, and this is 1 millimeter. And also now this is commercial, even there is a Israel Pride, because this company is a licensed technology from Tel Aviv University, and they sell it now all over the world. Okay, so these are some examples of nonlinear devices that we made in our lab. I should say that because this is a planar technique, we don't need to make it in a periodic structure or one-dimensional structure. We can do two-dimensional structures, and they can also be non-periodic. And so these are some examples of some devices that we made in our lab. I should also explain that how do we see that that we change the nonlinearity? We do some selective etching. The etching rate is different after we reverse the sign of the electric field, and then we can just look at the top surface or the bottom surface, and we can reveal the modulation. So, for example, this is an AFM scan of a two-dimensional structure, or you can see it also here. This is one-dimensional quasi-periodic structure. Here you can see circular symmetry structures. These are two-dimensional quasi-periodic structures. Some of these I hope I will mention later in the talk. Okay, so maybe now I'll move to some things that we are doing on quasi-periodic structures. And first, let me give some motivation why this is interesting. So what I've shown you so far is that if we do periodic modulation, one-dimensional periodic modulation, we can phase match a single process. This is actually what is shown here. This is shown in a reciprocal lattice space. So we have some k-vector that can be used to solve a single process. But what happens if we want to have several processes at the same time? Also, if we do two-dimensional structures, again, we have some more flexibility, but it's limited. It's only, again, this is a reciprocal lattice of a two-dimensional structure. So we can have delta k's, which are reciprocal lattice vectors. But if we want to phase match at some arbitrary directions, we cannot do it with the periodic structure. One of the solutions, this is the solution we chose, is to use quasi-periodic structures. And as I said, it was also mentioned yesterday, and also was, I think, an Israeli, Dan Shefman from the Technion, was the first to discover them in Nature. These are quasi-crystals. But probably before that, Fibonacci, I think, was the first. Maybe Ron will know someone before that. It was the first to study quasi-periodicity. And the problem with studies is how do rabbits breed? And in fact, if you arrange this is a very famous problem, and the solution is the Fibonacci series, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, and so on. But the number of the rabbit pairs is in fact a quasi-periodic sequence. So we want to use this for nonlinear optics, and also I'll explain why it solves our problem. So this is a quasi-periodic. This is an example of a one-dimensional quasi-periodic structure. And this is a crystal. So here we have some atoms, but you can see that they are not. This is not a periodic structure. There isn't any translation that you can make and reproduce what you started with. However, it's an ordered structure. If you do the Fourier transform of this, you get very, very sharp peaks. Okay. If it was a periodic structure, these peaks were only at some multiples of a basic frequency. But here you have much more flexibility. So you have more options to phase match processes, to phase match nonlinear processes. And there is a very nice way. I will not go into the details. We were very fortunate to collaborate with Ron Lifshitz on this. We borrowed some methods that were used in quasi-lithography, so in quasi-crystallography, to design quasi-periodic structures that can phase match a certain given processes. The method is called the dual grid method, and we are now applying it for nonlinear optics. So what I should say is that in the end, what we do, we have only positive and negative nonlinearity. These are the only things that we can do. And what we do is we create building blocks that are ordered in a quasi-periodic sequence. And in each one of these building blocks, we modulate the nonlinearity. So we have some positive and negative nonlinearity. So this is an example of such a structure. And the blue and the yellow areas are positive and negative nonlinearities. I'll show you several examples. This is a simple example. It was done by Alon Barbad, who is now in the University of Colorado, and Noah Volach, who is a PhD student in my group. This is a device to make a three-wave doubling, three-frequency doubling. Before I showed you how to frequency double one frequency, but here with this structure, this is not a barcode of this slide. This is the design. So this is the positive and negative nonlinearity. And then we can have three wavelengths, and in each one of them, we can have good efficiency. And this is the top surface of such a structure after selective etching. So you can see it's not a periodic structure, but it's efficient in the three wavelengths that we chose. Now, in order to convince you that it's not only for the lab, so I'll show you some example that is important for all of us. Because we are scientists, we love to fly. And now there is a major threat for airplanes by heat-seeking missiles. In fact, all the terrorist organizations in this region, they all have heat-seeking missiles that and in fact, there was already one attempt in Mombasa several years ago to bring down an airplane. So we need some way to protect against this problem. The heat-seeking missiles, the way they work, the engine is very hot in the airplane, and it emits light in the mid-infrared, about 4 microns. This is the peak emission. So the missile is simply looking for light at this wavelength. So the way to protect is we take on the airplane, we put some source that generates light at 4 microns, and this way we can deceive the missile. This is for an airplane. This is a system that ELOP already announced. It appears in the website. It's called MUSIC to protect helicopters. And so the problem is why you need nonlinear optics, because there are not good sources at 4 microns. So we have good sources at 1 micron, so we can take a 1 micron source, and when we put it into a nonlinear device, which is called an OPO, optical parametric oscillator, and this device generates 4 microns. The way it works is this pump, which is in 1 micron, is broken into two wavelengths. It's the kind of the opposite to second harmonic or some frequency generation. It's a down conversion process. So we can get two wavelengths, and again, we have energy conservation. And this is a little bit like a laser. This crystal is inside a cavity that resonates one of these wavelengths. And here you can see an example of such a structure, such a device in our lab. So there is a fundamental problem with these structures, with these OPOs, which they are very inefficient. And you can understand it because we start with 1 micron radiation, and we want to get 4 micron radiation. So this is 1 micron, this is 4 micron. So even if every photon at 1 micron is transferred to 4 micron, we will have only 25% efficiency. And in fact, we have about 10% efficiency because there are some other problems. So maybe we can do better. Well, we have this, we want this 4 micron light, but we have also this other photon that we get only because of energy conservation. This is at around 1.4. So maybe we can use it. Maybe we can just take this photon and convert it to another 4 micron photon. And for this, we need two processes at the same time. We need this OPO process, but we need another process that takes this signal wave and generates an idler wave for it. We call this a DFG process, and we need both of them at the same time. So now I showed that with quasi-periodic structures, we can do it. And in fact, we designed such a structure. I'm not going into the details. Again, this is not a periodic structure. Again, there are two building blocks which are ordered in some quasi-periodic sequence. And so we can measure the two processes independently. This is the OPO process, and this is the DFG process. And in fact, there is some point where they intersect. So if we work in this temperature, then we'll get the two processes at the same time. This is work by Gil Porat, a PhD student in my group. And in fact, this shows that this is the new device. This is the traditional device. So we have to operate, because we have another process, then the threshold is a bit higher, but then we have a higher slope efficiency and a higher efficiency. So it means that we can have with the same parameters, with the same pump parameters, we can get more light in the mid-infrared. So hopefully we'll be able to continue to fly to conferences safely. Okay, this can be also done in this two-dimensional, quasi-periodic structure can also be done in two dimensions. I think maybe I will skip the details because I want to talk a little bit about functional nonlinear devices. And so the I'll show you two examples of devices that, in addition to generating new wavelengths, we also add functionality to the device. And the first one is a deflector. So here we generate a new wavelength, we generate second harmonic, but we can also control the direction of the light. And how do we do it? So again, because we have now this flexibility of modulating the nonlinear coefficient, we can think of some new structures. So this structure, this is an example of the design, or this is the top surface of it, of a structure which is periodic in this direction, but it is chirped in the other direction. So if you look at the Fourier space, then actually this device, what you get is you get a kind of a continuous line. This is in the Fourier space. It means that it's in one condition we'll get the second harmonic here, but if we change the condition, we'll just travel along this line. So we will get in each let's say if, when we change the wavelength, we will move along this line. So we'll change the angle that is generated. Here, this is a symmetric device, so actually we will get two beams. We can also make anti-symmetric device that will make a beam only in one direction. This is a work was done by Tal Ellenbogen when he had more hair, and now he's in Harvard doing his postdoc. So the idea is that this is a characterization of such a device. We send laser light into this structure, and then we look here on the screen. So this is what you will see on the screen. And basically what we do is we change the wavelength of the input light, and as we do it, you can see that we actually can control the angle. It's a little bit, I don't know if you can see it, but you can change the angle of the generated wave. So this is a nonlinear deflector, where we not only generate second harmonic, but we can also control the direction. Okay, another example is on beam shaping, but first, again, because we have here a mixed audience, I want to say a few words about beams, optical beams at all. So what do we know about beams? So one thing is that they propagate in straight lines, right? And the other thing, this is diffraction. So this is an example of a diffraction of a beam, but I think probably you are more familiar with this diffraction. This is the beach in Tel Aviv. So you see that the sea waves, they come and they have to pass through this slit, and you can see that you get this diffraction. So the beam expands. However, about 2 years ago, it was shown that this does not have to be the case. There is a special kind of a beam. It's called an Airy beam. So it does not meet any of these things. First of all, so how does this beam look? This is the envelope of this beam. It's called an Airy beam because this is an Airy function. And what happens, how does it propagate in free space? So if you look at, for example, at this peak point, you will see that there is a kind of a parabolic trajectory. So this is why it's called an accelerating beam, like a beam but this happens in free space. There is any potential here. And the other thing is if it was an infinite beam, it was non-diffracting. It will this feature will keep its shape and will retain its shape as it propagates. So this is a very interesting beam. There is a lot of publications on it because it's very very unusual. So these are some suggestions of what we can do with it. We can maybe make curved plasma channels, or we can transport microparticles along this curved trajectory, so we can, for example, sort particles. If we can change the acceleration directions, we can have different boxes here, and we can have one particle to here and one particle to here. And the question is how to make these beams, and this is what was done so far. The idea is that we take a regular beam, a Gaussian beam, and then we go through a linear phase mask. What this phase mask is doing is it puts a cubic phase on this Gaussian beam. And then if you take a cubic phase and do Fourier transform, you will get this Airy beam. So optically, we do Fourier transform with a lens. So this is how we get an Airy beam. So our suggestion was to do the same with nonlinear optics. Rather than making a linear phase mask, now we have a nonlinear phase mask. So we have, again, a structure which is periodic in this direction, but it's chirped. It's cubically chirped in the other direction. And then we can get a cubic phase in the second harmonic. And then we do Fourier transform with the lens, and now we'll get an array beam at the second harmonic. And so this is the structure. This is this periodic structure in this direction, a chilled in the other direction. And this is what actually what we get. This is taken on the wall of the lab, and this is how the beam looks like. And in fact, the first thing was to verify that it's really an array beam. So we measured it at the different locations, and we see this parabolic trajectory. And the reason that we lose energy is because this is a finite beam. So it keeps its shape, but it loses energy. If it was an infinite beam, then it would not happen, but we don't have big enough labs in Tel Aviv for this. And just for comparison, this is the fundamental beam. So you can see that it goes in a straight line, and it suffers from diffraction. But more interesting than just generating the beam is because we do it in a nonlinear in nonlinear optics, we can also shape the beam. We can do all optical shaping. For example, we can shape the shape of the beam by changing parameters of the interaction, either changing the wavelength of the input wave or changing the temperature of the crystal. For example, here in this movie, you can see what happens when we send light and we change the wavelength of the input. And you can see that we have this, we can get a different shape of a beam. And this was also verified experimentally. Again, each time I show you this is the fundamental beam, which is just goes in a straight line and has diffraction. And this is this airy beam, but in different conditions. So you can see that we can shape the beam using this process. And moreover, we can also change the acceleration direction. For example, we can, by switching from a up conversion process like second harmonic to a down conversion process, for example, a different frequency generation, what happens is we change the sign of this cubic phase. And when we change the sign, we will change the direction of acceleration. So we can have either acceleration to the right or acceleration to the left. So here, this is what we expect. In one case, we will have acceleration to this side and the other to this side. This is work by Ido Dolev. And this was also verified experimentally. These are the two beams. This goes through the same crystal. We don't change the crystal. We only change the input wavelengths. So in one case, we get acceleration to the right. And the other case, we get acceleration to the left. So this means that by nonlinear optics, we can have not only the ability to generate new wavelengths, but we can also control the beam. Okay, so let me summarize. So I think the important thing is that we have now a lot of flexibility in designing nonlinear structures. There are some other structures that I didn't have time to talk with, but we are working on, like radial. I showed radial symmetry structure, but I didn't talk about it. There are also random or short-range order structures. These are also very interesting. And because we have this flexibility now, we can add functionality to the device. We can do deflectors, beam shapers. This I showed. I didn't show, but we do also switches and nonlinear lenses. And before I conclude, let me thank students that contribute to the work, and thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Ali.
Why it suffers from diffraction?
Why it doesn't?
It's like it's actually, this is not the first time. Also, there are Bessel beams, for example. It's the same case. There is one thing that we have to take into account, that infinite airy beam, also infinite Bessel beam, you need infinite energy and you need infinite labs. Okay. So we can all only work with finite beams, and therefore the shape is retained, but you lose energy. Sorry? For
generating
I didn't understand.
No, I was just trying to understand
why you're saying. Why? Which effect? Okay, it's a. I mean, this is a solution. This is a well-known. Well, let's say air is a bit new, but vessel beams are known, I think, from the 70s or maybe the beginning of the 80s. There are beams that propagate in free space, provided they have infinite energy, they will keep the shape.
Those in principle can be converted 100% to about 4 micron wave.
4? 1.3?
Yes. 1.3 times 3 is 3.9. And in principle, that we convert it completely to almost 4 micron.
Yeah. There are also, actually, there are 2 micron.
Exactly,
yeah.
Exactly the same
yeah.
process that you have described.
Yeah. Well, we are competing against some other technologies. There are even 2 micron sources now. There are fiber lasers, tulmium-holmium fiber lasers that are around 2 microns. But it's not very easy to make a 2 to 4 micron transition because you get a very broad spectrum at around 4 micron. And there are also techniques that are based on quantum cascade lasers that don't involve nonlinearity. But the nice thing about our proposal is that it relies on things that, for example, LOOP and their competitors, now they are using now. I mean, this quantum cascade is something for the future. Now they have 1 to 4 micron conversion, and you can just take their crystal and put our crystal, and all the other things remain the same. So this is an advantage at this point.
Can you do any manipulation with these effects throughout the amplitude of the radiation and not just the wavelength?
The amplitude, yes. Well, some of the things I showed do involve modulation of the amplitudes. There are things that I didn't show here deliberately induce defects in the nonlinear photonic crystal, and then we can move from constructive interference to destructive interference. What we can do it at some point we want to turn off the power, and then we put this defect and we turn it off, or we can partly turn it off, so we can have also control on this. And this is how we make nonlinear lenses.